Good morning. Good to see you this morning. Welcome to those who are visiting, and I see some more familiar faces from down south coming back to join us. Some announcements before we begin our worship service. First of all, another Sunday of noisy offering as we remember the ELCA World Hunger. And then this week's Holy Week schedule, starting with Wednesday, a service of silence from 5 p.m. to 7 p.m., a service of prayer and meditation, and there's a service booklet where there's plenty of information for you to contemplate. There will be communion as well, available to those who want it. Thursday is Maundy Thursday service, and it is remembering, of course, the last days in the upper room with the disciples, and then stripping of the altar after the service. And then Friday is the Good Friday service, service of darkness, the tenebrae worship service, and that one is available at noon and at 6:30, remembering the seven last words of Jesus from the cross. That service ends with darkness and some time of silence. Of course, next Sunday, our regular worship services for Easter, and then the Monday after Easter, the office is closed. And then one more announcement. The welcome meeting that was canceled because of this white stuff that came falling on Thursday, last week Thursday, has been rescheduled to this Monday, tomorrow, at 5 p.m. in the Fellowship Hall. The women are welcome to participate at that meeting. And if you got questions, you can contact Irene Seedorf. That's it for the announcements. And let's get ready to worship with our minds and hearts. Invite you to stand if you're able. We gather for worship in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. God of all mercy and consolation, come to the help of your people, turning us from our sin to live for you alone. Give us the power of your Holy Spirit, that we may confess our sin, receive your forgiveness, and grow into the fullness of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake, God forgives us all our sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ and by his authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Thank you. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Let us pray. Sovereign God, you have established your rule in the human heart through the servanthood of Jesus Christ. By your Spirit, keep us in the joyful procession of those who with their tongues confess Jesus as Lord, and with their lives praise him as Savior, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated. I invite you to stand. The gospel reading for this Palm Sunday is from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 19. After Jesus had said this, he went on ahead, going up to Jerusalem. And when he had come near Bethphage and Bethany at the place called the Mount of Olives, he sent two of the disciples, saying, "Go into the village ahead of you, and as you enter it, you will find tied there a colt that has never been ridden. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone asks you, 'Why are you untying it?' just say this, 'The Lord needs it.' So those who were sent departed and found it as he had told them. And as they were untying the colt, its owner asked them, 'Why are you untying the colt?' And they said, 'The Lord needs it.' Then they brought it to Jesus, and after throwing their cloaks on the colt, they set Jesus on it. And as he rode along, people kept spreading their cloaks on the road. And as he was now approaching the path down from the Mount of Olives, the whole multitude of the disciples began to praise God joyfully with a loud voice for all the deeds of power that they had seen, saying, 'Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest heaven.' And some of the Pharisees in the crowd said to him, 'Teacher, order your disciples to stop.' And he answered, 'I tell you, if these were silent, the stones would shout out.'" The Gospel of the Lord. You may be seated. People of God, grace, peace, and mercy be to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ. Amen. So this is a day we wave our palm branches and we shout, "Hosanna, blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest." Those are the traditional words anyway. That's the traditional actions anyway. This is my first Palm Sunday here with you. And I notice that you don't have palms. We'll have to change that for next year. For some reason, I think they save all those palms for the second service. I don't know, but we'll see. It's my first experience. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. This phrase is from Psalm 118 and was originally part of the liturgy recited when the king returned victorious in war. And as the king, grateful to God for his success on the field of battle, he would then approach the temple to engage in thankful worship. The priest would then say, "Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed are you from the house of the Lord." However, by the time Jesus, this phrase had become a standard greeting for pilgrims coming to Jerusalem for the Passover festival. You can imagine thousands and hundreds of thousands of people making a pilgrimage to the holy temple city of Jerusalem for the Passover. And as the travelers streamed into the city, people would say to them, "Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord." It was, in effect, "Welcome to Jerusalem. Enjoy the festival." Okay? Have a nice day. Now, if we want to know what the festival crowd was really expecting when they greeted Jesus that day, a better clue could be found in the palm branches they waved. Wait a minute. Were there palm branches in the scripture reading we just read? Good. I'm glad you noticed that. Palm branches. In the Gospel of Luke for today, "And after throwing their cloaks on the colt, they set Jesus on it. And as he rode along, people kept spreading their cloaks on the road. And as he now approached the path down from the Mount of Olives, the whole multitude of the disciples began to praise God joyfully with a loud voice for all the deeds of power that they had seen, saying, "Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest heaven." Well, let's look at the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 21. It reads this: "A very large crowd spread their cloaks on the road, and others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road." Closer. Let's take a look at the Gospel of Mark, chapter 11. We read, "Many people spread their cloaks on the road, and others spread leafy branches that they cut in the fields." What could that be? And then from the Gospel of John, chapter 12, we read, "The next day, the great crowd that had come to the festival heard that Jesus was coming to Jerusalem, so they took branches of palm trees and went out to meet him." A lot closer. Wait a moment. Palm branches. They're in John, but they're not in the other Gospels. But where's this Hosanna? Hosanna, blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna! Where's that? Well, Matthew has the crowd shouting, "Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest heaven." There it is. Then Mark has the crowd shouting, "Hosanna! Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our ancestor David. Hosanna in the highest heaven." There it is. And then John, the Gospel of John says, has the crowd shouting, "Hosanna! Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord, the King of Israel." Our reading for today, Luke tells us this way. He has the crowd shouting, "Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest heaven." Our version today has no palms and no hosannas. Interesting. We expect palm branches for Palm Sunday. We expect Hosanna for Palm Sunday. This is Palm Sunday. It is, isn't it? Yeah, okay. Because next week is Easter. So this is supposed to be Palm Sunday. What's going on here? This is not what I expected. We know what happens when people assume too much. When people assume, they have expectations. We make it worse when these assumptions and expectations are not communicated. And usually it doesn't end well. Unfortunately, we live in a world where we do too much assuming without communicating our expectations. Clear communication and good listening skills are extremely important in order to alleviate any misunderstanding or assumptions and expectations. However, we live in an age where we rely too much on emails and text messaging, which can result in many misunderstandings. Has this ever happened to you? Running assumptions and expectations have always been a problem in communication, not just in emails and text messaging. We've all experienced times when there have been misunderstandings, And we thought we communicated very clearly, and yet the other person doesn't seem to understand. Palm Sunday was a day of high expectations and many running assumptions about Jesus. Stories about Jesus circulated throughout his 3 years of ministry. People talked about Jesus as a miracle worker. He heals diseases. He makes the blind see, the lame walk, raises the dead back to life. They talked about Jesus who could even command the wind and the waves. And they were enamored by him as he taught one with authority. He reminded them of the great prophets of old. And he comes in the lineage of King David. Could he be the promised Messiah? And would he reestablish the kingdom of David? Would he rule with might and overthrow the Roman rule and empire? Will he declare himself to be the new king of the Jews? Can he save us? Can he establish peace among us? Will he feed the hungry? Will the meek inherit the kingdom? Hosanna! Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna! There were plenty of running assumptions and expectations placed upon Jesus that day. And I'm sure Jesus was aware of most, if not all of them. He knew they were misplaced expectations and assumptions as he rode upon his donkey into Jerusalem. The crowd did not know. They did not understand the full truth of Jesus. They knew only a glimpse and their perceptions of Jesus. What they did not fully hear and understand were the words, "This is my son, the beloved, with whom I am well pleased." Soon the cheers of Hosanna, "Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord," is changed, dramatically changed. "He is not the one I expected. He is not the king to overthrow anyone. This Jesus doesn't even defend himself. This Jesus is from this little backward hick town called Nazareth." "Oh, but I did hear that his father is Joseph and mother Mary. And are they of royal blood?" In a few days, the crowds yelling and chanting changes. They're waving palm branches, spreading their cloaks, but it changes. Soon it's "Crucify him. Crucify him." Jesus never expected praise or assumed he would be fully understood. God sent his son into the world knowing that his son would be rejected, persecuted. God didn't expect or assume that human nature would be any different. God didn't have high expectations. God didn't assume much at all. God knows full well that we all fall short of God's glory. God expects disappointment. God expects you will take his love for granted. God expects that you will worship him mostly out of obligation. God expects that you will neglect others who are in need. God expects that we will continue to harm and destroy one another emotionally, physically, and even spiritually. And a couple days later, you will hear another voice, a voice from the cross, our Lord and Savior's voice. Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. There is only one guarantee, life and forgiveness in Jesus Christ. God's promise in Jesus Christ is the only assumption and expectation that is certain. Thanks be to God. Amen. Trusting in Christ's Passover from death into new life, we pray for the church, those in need, and all of God's creation. God, most holy and humble, plant in your church Christ's spirit of humility. Remove any barriers preventing us from seeing his work on the cross. Hear us, O God. You reveal your will for all creation through stones, seas, mountains, and meadows. In the splendor of what you have made, show us your care for everything, great and small. Hear us, O God. Rescue those who suffer torture and free those held captive by others. Bring to light the hidden systems that perpetuate injustice among your people. Hear us, O God. Pour courage and hope into people who feel like they are wasting away in distress and grief. Restore their trust in you, even as you meet their every need. Hear us, O God. Open our hearts and minds to receive the words that you speak. Give us words to encourage the weary and to sustain one another in word and deed. Hear us, O God. Gather your saints into the new covenant that Christ has established for all creation. And when we fall into sin, continually renew us until Christ dwells with us again in fullness. Hear us, O God. Attend to the needs of the whole world with your saving grace, and lead us all into new life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We will now receive the offering. Thank you. Let us pray. Generous God, you feed us with the harvest of the land, and you provide for our every need. Receive our gifts of money, imagination, and labor, and transform them into a feast that welcomes all. In Jesus Christ, our host and our guest. Amen. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, and broke it, gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in remembrance of me." Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. I would invite assistants forward at this time. In communion, and just a reminder, we have the wafers, and inside in the center are gluten-free wafers available on both sides. We have wine and grape juice in the chalices, and we will commune by intinction. That means you place your wafer into the wine or grape juice and then take both elements together. If you are extremely gluten-free, we have a gluten-free wine on this side. Would you guys come all the way up here, please? Let us pray. Tender and merciful God, at your feast, you feed us who have brought nothing, turning our emptiness into joy. Filled with your abundant grace, send us now to be ministers of reconciliation, mending broken hearts, working for justice, and striving for peace among all people. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen.
Is from the book of Luke, chapters 22, verses 39 to 71. A reading from Luke. He came out and went, as was his custom, to the Mount of Olives, and the disciples followed him. When he reached the place, he said to them, "Pray that you may not come into the time of trial." Then he withdrew from them about a stone's throw, knelt down and prayed, "Father, if you are willing, remove this cup from me, yet not my will but yours be done." Then an angel from heaven appeared to him and gave him strength. In his anguish he prayed more earnestly, and his sweat became like drops of blood falling down on the ground. When he got up from prayer, he came to the disciples and found them sleeping because of grief. And he said to them, "Why are you sleeping? Get up and pray that you may not come into the time of trial." While he was speaking, suddenly a crowd came, and the one called Judas, one of the 12, was leading them. He approached Jesus to kiss him, but Jesus said to him, "Judas, is it with a kiss that you are betraying the Son of Man?" When those who were around him saw what was coming, they asked, "Lord, should we strike with the sword?" Then one of them struck the slave of the high priest and cut off his right ear. But Jesus said, "No more of this." And he touched his ear and healed him. Then Jesus said to the chief priests, the officers of the temple police, and the elders who had come for him, "Have you come out with swords and clubs as if I were a bandit? When I was with you day after day in the temple, you did not lay hands on me. But this is your hour in the power of darkness." Then they seized him and led him away, bringing him into the high priest's house. But Peter was following at a distance. When they had kindled a fire in the middle of the courtyard and sat down together, Peter sat among them. And then a servant girl, seeing him in the firelight, stared at him and said, "This man also was with him." But he denied it, saying, "Woman, I do not know him." A little later, someone else, on seeing him, said, "You also are one of them." But Peter said, "Man, I am not." Then about an hour later, yet another kept insisting, "Surely this man also was with him, for he is a Galilean." But Peter said, "Man, I do not know what you're talking about." At that moment, while he was still speaking, the cock crowed. The Lord turned and looked at Peter. Then Peter remembered the word of the Lord, how he had said to him, "Before the cock crows today, you will deny me three times." And he went out and wept bitterly. Now the men who were holding Jesus began to mock him and beat him. They also blindfolded him and kept asking him, "Prophesy, who is it that struck you?" Then they kept heaping many other insults upon him. Then day came, the assembly of the elders of the people, both chief priests and scribes, gathered together, and they brought him to their council. They said, "If you are the Messiah, tell us." He replied, "If I tell you, you will not believe. And if I question you, you will not answer. But from now on, the Son of Man will be seated at the right hand of the power of God." All of them asked, "Are you then the Son of God?" He said to them, "You say that I am." Then they said, "What further testimony do we need?" We have heard it ourselves from his own lips, the word of the Lord. The gospel lesson is from the book of Luke, chapter 23, verses 1 to 56, a reading from Luke. Then the assembly rose as a body and brought Jesus before Pilate. They began to accuse him, saying, "We found this man perverting our nation, forbidding us to pay taxes to the emperor, and saying that he himself is the Messiah, a king." Then Pilate asked him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" He answered, "You say so." Then Pilate said to the chief priests and the crowds, "I find no basis for an accusation against this man." But they were insistent and said, "He stirs up the people by teaching throughout all Judea, from Galilee where he began, even to this place." When Pilate heard this, he asked whether the man was a Galilean. And when he learned that he was under Herod's jurisdiction, he sent him off to Herod, who was himself in Jerusalem at that time. When Herod saw Jesus, he was very glad, for he had been wanting to see him for a long time, because he had heard about him and was hoping to see him perform some signs. He questioned him at some length, but Jesus gave him no answer. The chief priests and the scribes stood by, vehemently accusing him. Even Herod with his soldiers treated him with contempt and mocked him. Then he put an elegant robe on him and sent him back to Pilate. That same day, Herod and Pilate became friends with each other. Before this, they had been enemies. Pilate then called together the chief priests, the leaders, and the people and said to them, "You brought me this man as one who is perverting the people. And here I have examined him in your presence and have not found this man guilty of any of your charges against him. Neither has Herod, for he sent him back to us. Indeed, he has done nothing to deserve death. I will therefore have him flogged and release him." Then they all shouted out together, "Away with this fellow! Release Barabbas for us." This was a man who had been put in prison for an insurrection that had taken place in the city, and for murder. Pilate, wanting to release Jesus, addressed them again, but they kept shouting, "Crucify him! Crucify him!" A third time he said to them, "Why? What evil has he done? I have found him in no ground for the sentence of death. I will therefore have him flogged and then release him." But they kept urgently demanding with loud shouts that he should be crucified, and their voices prevailed. So Pilate gave his verdict that their demand should be granted. He released the man they asked for, the one who had been put in prison for insurrection and murder, and he handed Jesus over as they wished. As they led him away, they seized a man, Simon of Cyrene, who was coming from the country, and they laid the cross on him and made him carry it behind Jesus. A great number of the people followed him, and among them were women who were beating their breasts and wailing for him. But Jesus turned to them and said, "Daughters of Jerusalem, do not weep for me, but weep for yourselves and for your children. For the days are surely coming when they will say, 'Blessed are the barren, and the wombs that never bore, and the breasts that never nursed.' Then they will begin to say to the mountains, 'Fall on us,' and to the hills, 'Cover us.' For if they do this, when the wood is green, what will happen when it is dry?" Two others also, who were criminals, were led away to be put to death with him. When they came to the place that is called the Skull, they crucified Jesus there with the criminals, one on his right and one on his left. Then Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing." And they cast lots to divide his clothing, and the people stood by watching, but the leaders scoffed at him, saying, "He saved others, let him save himself if he is the Messiah of God, his chosen one." The soldiers also mocked him, coming up and offering him sour wine and saying, "If you are the King of Jews, save yourself." There was also an inscription over him, "This is the King of the Jews." One of the criminals who were hanged there kept deriding him and saying, "You are not the Messiah. Save yourself and us." But the other rebuked him, saying, "Do you not fear God, since you are under the same sentence of condemnation? And we indeed have been condemned justly, for we are getting what we deserve for our deeds. But this man has done nothing wrong." Then he said, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." He replied, "Truly I tell you, today you will be with me in paradise." It was now about noon, and the darkness came over in the whole land until 3 p.m, while the sun's light failed, and the curtain of the temple was torn in two. Then Jesus, crying with a loud voice, said, "Father, into your hands I commend my spirit." Having said this, he breathed his last. When the centurion saw what had taken place, he praised God and said, "Certainly this man was innocent." And when all the crowds who had gathered there for this spectacle saw what had taken place, they returned home, beating their breasts. But all his acquaintances, including the woman who had followed him from Galilee, stood at a distance, watching these things. Now there was a good and righteous man named Joseph, who, through a member of the council, had not agreed to their plan and action. He came from the Jewish town of Arimathea, and he was waiting expectantly for the kingdom of God. This man went to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. Then he took it down, wrapped it in a linen cloth, and laid it in a rock-hewn tomb, where no one had ever been laid. It was the day of preparation, and the Sabbath was beginning. The woman who had come with him from Galilee followed, and they saw the tomb and how his body was laid. Then they returned and prepared spices and ointments. On the Sabbath, they rested according to the commandment. The word of the Lord.
Praise.